Welcome to the Scale Model Podcast. In this podcast, we aim to entertain, inform, and promote the hobby of scale model kit building with interviews, reviews, and news about the hobby. The Scale Model Podcast is currently recorded bi-weekly and is available where your favorite podcasts are found, including iTunes, Google Play, and Stitcher, as well as our website at www.scalemodelpodcast.com. Let us know if you have any comments or suggestions at scalemodelpodcast@gmail.com or at our Facebook page at facebook.com/scalemodelpodcast. We also publish extra video content on our YouTube channel, and we also have a Patreon page at patreon.com/scalemodelpodcast. The money raised will be used to help offset web hosting and other costs. As the podcast grows, we hope to introduce giveaway and other bonuses to our Patreon supporters as a thank you for supporting the Scale Model Podcast. Welcome to episode 20 of the Scale Model Podcast, sponsored by Goodman Models. My name is Stuart Clark, and once again, we are in the deep, dark, hidden recesses of Goodman Models, where there is a new auto assembly wing being built. I've been given a tour of the advanced robotic stuff, and we've just come back into Anthony's workshop, taking off our hard hats, and here he is.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hello. So, yeah, so Goodman Models, car modeling. I guess that's because of our good friends at On the Bench.
Yes.
We threw down the challenge to them.
We did.
And they've thrown a challenge back to us. And we're gonna talk about that towards the end of the show.
Yeah,
but
absolutely, yeah.
Basically involves Ian's going to build a Gundam, and you're going to build a late 60s, hopefully a Mopar car.
Yeah, we were throwing around a couple ideas.
Yeah, exactly. And this is going to be for, what was the name of the cup again?
The Musaru Cup.
Musaru Cup. I think that was Ian that came up with that, or one of the guys down there.
Well done.
I like that. I'm going to work on a coat of arms or a logo.
Perfect.
Something involving a kangaroo and a moose in a compromising position or something, maybe. Who knows?
That
should set back Canada-Australian relations another 20 years, right?
Absolutely.
Exactly. So lots of stuff going on. Tons of shows. We had the AMP show, the Shizuka hobby show, all sorts of things. So
lots of news.
So let's get it right on to it. Oh, and I should point out, I did remember to bring Anthony his AK interactive weathering pencils.
Yes,
so he's going to be trying those in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, I'm gonna sample your set here on my Aliens APC.
Yeah, you're making good progress there.
You brought me the green and brown.
Mm-hmm.
Shading and effects set, and I'm gonna work that out. We tried it actually a little bit tonight, and I'll work it out as I kind of get close to finishing that up, and
exactly.
We'll put some pictures up for sure.
Exactly. Okay, so we're gonna go to the latest news, and don't forget, as always, we always have links and even some pictures on our website at scalemodelpodcast.com if you go to the appropriate show note for each episode. So let's start off with AMPS. And I know this is what's the acronym again? The Armor Model Preservation Society,
yep,
right?
I got it.
I know this is one you wanted to go to because it was only about 2 hours away, but as you know, as happens,
didn't work out this
life,
time.
Life gets in, but
yeah.
I saw some pretty amazing work coming out of there.
Yeah, I love the AMPS. That's the club I'm currently a member of.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of those shows is that the judging system is a merit-based system, and I really like that, so
okay.
It's worth mentioning again. So you get, when you go to the show and you enter your model kit in the competition, I find this a definite sort of style of judging with a lot of care, and they really look at them closely, and I think they actually provide a bit of feedback.
Okay.
And I actually would love to, I haven't had a kit ready to go into one yet, but I really would like to get that feedback.
Okay.
And so I'm very excited about getting something ready and getting into one of the AMP shows. I was at AMPS, our local show.
Yes, our local chapter.
The Great White North version.
Mm-hmm.
And I was vending. I didn't have anything ready, you know, and then I think I missed last year, but this year I really wanted to go to this is the Nationals.
It was close. It was like 2 hours away.
I heard there were 600 models on the table, which
there
is
was quite a good
great
turnout.
Number. Yeah.
We've included some links. There's only a couple photo galleries been out. We're actually recording this on Monday night, and the show was on Saturday. But I have put a link to a photo gallery that Scott Beringi, and if I've fouled up your name, my apologies. He shot quite a few photos, and there's some pretty impressive stuff on there, so definitely worth checking out. I just had a quick look on the AMPS page. They still have to put some photos up there. Next year's convention is across the river from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. So still reasonably close to us, so that won't be bad. And the best of show this year was by Scott, a 9K35 Strela 10. There's no photo yet. So I don't know what that
is.
So do you know what that is?
I do not know.
Okay, well, there we go. We will see the pictures. Anyway, I've included Scott's photo gallery as well. So definitely check that out. While we're talking about shows, we're going to be going to Torcan.
Yep, that's
so
coming up this
month. Torcan is in 2 weeks. So it's on the Saturday, and in theory we record on the Sunday, so we might record on the Monday. So that's in Toronto, just west of Toronto, so it's only about 2 hours away from us.
There you go.
Oh, is that what that? Oh, okay.
Looks like a Russian rocket launcher, mobile rocket launcher.
9K35 Strela, yeah. Okay, looks good. Anyway, Torcan. So it's May 25th at the Century Gardens in Brampton, Ontario. Mm-hmm. It's put on by our good friends at the Peel Scale Modelers. So the Scale Model Podcast will be there again.
We will.
Getting some interviews and stuff like that. Are you doing any demos again?
Yes, I do have. I'm going to be doing another demo with Flexifile.
Okay. So they'll be there again. So for the hundreds of fans that were upset that they missed their demo at Heritage Con,
they'll be there.
We'll be back for a return engagement.
Yeah, singles for sale, sets for sale. That's actually, I got to say, the shows are the best price around.
There you go, kids.
If you're local, if you can get down to one, the shows are where you save a few bucks.
There you go. Yeah. So you heard it here first. So yeah, this is always a really good show. It's been a few years since I've been to one, but I'm looking forward to getting back there again. Always a good time. So that'll be good. I've got a link to their website there. So as I said, May 25th. And if you look for Anthony and I, I'll probably be the one with the face for radio with the microphone going around. But we will have our
picture,
little... Yeah, I did have a picture. So yeah. I was going to talk about that where we...
need a picture of the two of us, like back to back.
We need a picture of the two of us, yeah, or something like that.
Looking over our shoulders.
That might just scare the internet. I don't know.
Something like classic 70s, like news professionals would...
News professionals, I think, like classic 70 cop buddies.
Yes, yeah, even better.
Something like that. Anyway, we will have our name tags representing the Scale Model Podcast. So you'll see us there. Yeah. And again, you'll see Anthony with his sanding sticks,
sanding blocks. I'll be there.
You'll be there. So definitely check that out. So that was pretty good. Okay, the other absolutely huge show was Japan last weekend.
Yeah.
The 58th annual Shizuoka. Okay.
Shizuoka.
Okay. What he said.
Oh, it's a big one.
Hobby Show 2019. This is the...
It's huge.
This is the big show. This is on par with, like, the, the annual Nuremberg Toy Fair and stuff like that in Europe.
I think this is the biggest one for
Japan. This is the biggest.
Japan.
Yeah. And this is all hobby stuff. So it's not only model kits, but radio control and stuff like that. This was actually, I believe, a 5-day event this year. They extended a day. So again, we've got some... images, a lot of links, what stuff that was released. I know a lot of the Japanese companies, this is where they tend to really announce new things.
Yes.
So Bandai, Tamiya, stuff like that. Always pretty good. So again, our good friends at the Modeling News got in during Industry Day with some of the new products. And I'm just scrolling down here. So one of the things they had, AFE Club, they've got a 1/48 scale U2 Dragon Lady. I know we've talked about it before, but this thing's huge. Again, if you remember what the real plane, the spy plane.
Yeah. Monstrous.
Yep. Also, their Achilles Mark IIc, that was the 17-pounder anti-tank tank destroyer. They also have an M108 105mm howitzer, M18. So a lot of new products coming out there. Another manufacturer, Aoshima, they have some new car models. They're quite known in Japan for their car models.
Yeah.
They're quite big for that. Yeah. I think you've got a couple, if I recall in your name.
Yeah, I think I do have a couple. Okay. Kids. I haven't built any yet.
And then there's this one Gundam here, the Grim Reaper Edelstein from Titan Omacha, collaboration between... You want to try those?
Yeah, so Aoshima, Kotobukiya, God Hand.
And another big name.
Yeah, so Kotobukiya... It does model kits.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a Gundam, though, I don't think.
I don't know. It looks like something big they're going to be doing.
It's very
impressive. Two impressive-looking mechs in a poster.
Yeah. So, sorry, scroll back up there.
Yeah.
It's, yeah, it looks very cool, very science fiction-y. So God Hand, from what I understand, makes really high-end tools. And okay. I have a set of their nippers, and they're really good.
Okay.
And then Kotobukiya does a lot of, like, aftermarket parts, which are really fantastic. And they do some kits, I don't know of what, like maybe Zoids or like some kind of science fiction series.
Right.
But, yeah, they're quite big. I remember I went to the Kotobukiya shop in...
When you were there?
In Akihabara.
Yep, okay.
And, yeah, it was pretty cool.
Okay, Bandai, a lot of stuff. They have a 15,000 Star Destroyer with the LED set. We talked about that, and they had it out there.
Okay, Stuart, gray or white?
Gray. I know, this the inevitable argument. White. I like gray. Hey, my model, I'll build it the way I bloody well
It's
want.
White in the movie.
We'll have to ask Mr. Sparkles, who's sitting up in front of your mech again.
No, it's okay. Variety is good, right? And it's one of those things that, you know, the way it appears on the screen to your eye.
It looks like they've got some new Star Blazer stuff coming out. So that looks like from Star Blazers.
That's a really popular...
A very popular franchise.
Coming in forever.
Yep. Yep, so some
Votoms.
Some Votoms. Yeah, lots of stuff again on the links. Well, from a certain movie coming out.
Pokemon kits. Never seen that before. Makes sense.
Beaver Corporation. This is like these guys import a lot of stuff into Japan from the smaller manufacturers, or even like non-Japanese, like Airfix and that.
Really?
So yeah, they featured the Model Collect. This is a B-52. I think this is the 172nd scale.
This one?
Yeah, I have heard someone's coming out with a 148 scale.
Oh, yeah, you're right. 172nd. Yeah.
But there's a 148th one being planned.
Crazy.
Yeah, I know.
That's going to be one of those high, big ticket.
Yeah, where the hell do you put it? That's what I always say.
You're going to have it with detachable wings.
They're going to have
spars that you can slot in.
Detachable wings, detachable engines. You have to supply your own garage or wing of your house to put it in.
Yeah.
So, yes. Mr. Sparkles, our show mascot, is now
here.
He's here. Interior Jag Panther, a new patent. So, yeah, just lots and lots of goodies. We'll mention a few things, but again, the links I've given supply quite a lot of stuff. Like I said, this is a huge industry event. It's always worth kind of seeing. And again, it reminds us that how big, I still think a lot of North American and European modelers don't realize how big the Far East market is.
Oh, man. Modeling culture is... Like, it's so huge in Japan. Like, let me give you a quick little aside. So when I was definitely kind of on a trip to Mecca when I was in Japan for modeling stuff, and I was hunting down rare books and rare kits, and I saw even more rare stuff that was out of my league, but it was nice to see. But the model shops there were like five stories high,
right?
And a lot of buildings they build up. They're very like narrow, skinny and narrow, but they build up. So you're on the street level, and you're like, there's a hobby shop, and it's like nothing but Gundam kits, and science fiction.
Yep.
So you go in through it, you look around, you're like, all right, would like to get this or that, and then there's a little stairway at the back, and you go up the stairway, and you're in nothing but armor. It's like a whole floor dedicated to armor.
Right.
And then you go up and then it's all trains. And you go up one more and it's all like airsoft. And that's sort of like it's sort of like cosplay where they have like guns and stuff that are like one-to-one scale, but they shoot air pellets? Airsoft is a huge thing.
Okay, is it? Okay.
There's a lot of reenactment stuff like World War II.
Right.
Nazis, modern stuff.
Right. I gotta get a picture because right now the cat is on Anthony's
He does
shoulder.
That right when he I'm wants about his, to apply
he
something.
Wants his, he wants his he wants his loving. So let's see here. There you go. Okay,
that's where he hangs out when I'm trying to do something delicate.
Exactly. Here you go. All right. So yeah. So a lot of stuff coming out. Like again, Hasegawa, for example, they've got 1/400 scale Crusher Joe, the Starship Minerva. I think we talked about that before. For some reason, I think I've seen that.
The Minerva. Yeah, that's cool. So Crusher Joe is like a fairly established animation science fiction series in Japan. It's been out. Like came out in the early 80s.
Fine Molds. It's the 80th anniversary of the Zero Fighter. So they've got a couple of new historic ones.
Those are nice. I'd like to build the very first one, prototype one.
Yeah, that'd be kind of neat.
It's like all beige.
About. Yep. Yeah, so a lot of the stuff coming out, like, for example, Tamiya, you know, some of it's already been announced, but, again, they actually had a chance to see it. So several things there. All sorts of stuff. We could do a whole show just on what came out of
Maybe
this.
Maybe we'll have to.
We may have to, the way we're going here, I tell you.
Oh, yeah, let's go back up. They have that zero, the beautiful... Oh, the
Doshima. Yeah, this was a 32nd scale, the Type 21.
So this three is the, versions. This is the Doyusha, which is a company that I'm not familiar with, but like I've heard of them, but I haven't built anything.
They do all sorts of things. They do RC, and they do... looks like they do stuff with the human body.
Is that a late? That's a late...
That looks like a late one. Type 21 would be a later version.
Yeah. The zeros are pretty. Like the zero.
No, the zero's a nice, looking thing. So, again, definitely check out these pages. We're sending the links.
Yeah, you'll see all the links. New stuff.
Now, there's one cool thing. I've got a link to a YouTube video here, and this was taken in the clubs area of the...
this is amazing.
The club hall. So, about 1:59 in, about 2 minutes in, there is a ship. Gorgeous looking. I'd say, I don't know if it was 350th or 700th, but they were projecting somehow to make it look like it was traveling through the ocean with the wave and everything.
Oh, so cool.
You got to check it out. Yeah. So definitely check that out. The whole video is quite good with what some of the clubs come up with. So definitely check that out. Couple other specific news that caught our eye, and I remember seeing this one. So Amusing Hobbies is coming out with a Badger Tank Destroyer. This was actually a paper panzer. And it was actually designed by the British. And basically, it's now in World of Tanks. So there's the cross collaboration, as we've talked about before. This thing was based on, the one they've built here was based on two different prototypes. It never really went anywhere. But it's an impressive looking beast. So like it had like a 155 mil gun. They never built one, obviously. There was no official nickname, so it's the Badger's most likely fictional, but they've kind of adapted it from World of Tanks, because it's in World of Tanks.
So, now, from what I understand, the world... I haven't played that game. I'm not a big gamer, but the tanks are not exactly real. They're sort of like...
It varies. Yeah, they look like it, and then they do their own stats.
But they're kind of like science fiction-y.
But they do take real-world designs or what-if designs. So this one here, this was actually... there was two proposals. There was a wooden mock-up, and that's as far as it got. Like, so they've combined it.
Yeah, okay, so they've dressed it up with
this is a what-if.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they had obviously images, right?
Yeah, diagrams. Like when we talk about... Yeah, like this was the mock-up. Like when we talk about Paper Panthers.
Yeah.
This was designed as a self-propelled medium anti-tank gun. A scale model was built in 47, but the project was canceled in 49. So they built it up, and it's quite impressive. Like, there's a great honking great cannon on this thing.
It looks really cool. Yeah. And I think it's really neat to have like a... Like a British sort of prototype. Yeah,
exactly. Exactly. And you were mentioning about Bandai and Games Workshop are working on something.
Yeah, so this was just announced that Bandai and Games Workshop, the maker of Warhammer, are teaming up to make new figures. So I understand that. So we posted a link to an article in Forbes discussing this if you want to check it out. But that's kind of a big news. Like, the Games Workshop stuff is quite expensive, I think. For people, I've heard that
it's been a criticism from people. The molding in that is very good, and the company is very successful, so they're doing something right. And people are buying them,
people love it, and they obviously are,
but it's expensive.
Yeah, it's kind of a high ticket item, but they've been trying to get a hold in the Japanese market, and so now they've teamed up with Bandai to produce some of this Grimdark stuff. So I don't really know what's going on, but they're doing Primaris Space Marine action figures.
Yeah, so they're making stuff for Warhammer 40K.
Yeah.
So the Space Marine. So 7-inch, that's pretty huge.
Yeah. So like, would that be a game piece?
That's a bloody big game piece. No, I think these are designed for display. So like the game pieces are normally like... they're normally like an inch and a half.
Yeah.
This individual space.
So they're mostly making model kits.
Right. So they're basically making a model kit of some of the stuff.
So this stuff was displayed at the Shizuoka Hobby Show. And people are saying it's looking pretty good. So there's a number of different subjects that they're doing, the Ordo Herectus Inquisitor and
these are all units in the 40K universe. I think again this is more based on the instead of using for gaming, they're display
like traditional models.
Exactly. So I can see that.
I guess they've opened up a store in Harajuku.
Yep, Games Workshop has. And again, their molding's very good, but again, like them and Bandai, they're two of the most successful companies in the modeling universe.
I think it's also about like the licensing for the marketplace. It's easier to team up for a specific locale than it is to try and...
Well, and as the article says, Bandai's got a very good distribution setup.
Oh, yeah.
Right, how they get their product around. Again, they've got the Star Wars license.
Yeah, they're masters at it.
So they're very good at getting that stuff. Yeah. So
I remember walking around at the train station. A lot of train stations had kind of like parkades where you'd have like a newsstand. And in the newsstands were model kits.
Oh, cool.
Right?
Yeah.
Because like when I was a kid, there were hobby shops, right?
Yeah.
But I think when, you know, the older generation, when they were a kid in the 60s, like
every drugstore, every department store, everyone, because that's what people
had model kits, right? And that sort of went away. And I thought that was really interesting. I'd get off work and I'd be heading home on the thing and I'd stop to get a coffee, a cold coffee in a can from a vending machine.
Well, of course. Everything's in a vending machine.
And then you're like, oh, look at this. They got a whole bunch of like Gundam kits and this and that.
But that's what sells. And that's what I keep, I keep telling people. And I, you know, it's funny when we go on Facebook and things like that, we see people complain, oh, the kids aren't into, you know, well, it's true, it's a different generation. And you hear the same thing in the model railroad world. I talked to some model railroaders, the guys that are into that now, they want the modern diesels, you know, you tend to want to model the stuff you've seen. Right.
Yeah. I think a lot of people, it's like the subjects that caught their attention when they're like a child or whatever. Or a teenager.
Exactly.
Those are the things that really capture your fascination. Yeah.
And again, they wouldn't make this stuff if it didn't sell. So, yeah. So, you know what? Some of the stuff I would consider, because I have a couple of the smaller Warhammer figures.
Yeah.
The whole franchise is very good.
Did you ever play it? Like, get
once or twice? I've never really got into it that much. It was a bit too pricey for my blood.
Oh, you got to pay a lot, eh?
Well, some of them are. But like I said, there's all these similar, like there's Bolt Action now, which is World War II. But again, you build your and paint your miniature army.
Yeah.
It's very, very popular. People are really into it. I never really got into it.
I've noticed that this is right now, in my observation, this is the big trend in the modeling world, is that it's the gaming and elevating the painting and the building. Mm-hmm. And a lot of hobby shops are running. I can think of Section 8 Hobbies, just open a location, Section 8 Gaming, where they're running the tournaments or having
guild
nights.
Because you have the room to tables.
Game nights.
Yeah, like set we up have for a, all that. We have a store.
They do Bolt Action.
Yeah, we have a store here in London that does that. They have a gaming room, the Game Chamber.
Game Chamber.
They have a room with a bunch of tables, and they have terrain, or they have like buildings. Yeah. You don't have to bring your own building. You just bring your own army, you know, and they provide, you know, sometimes it's pay to play. They might pay a couple
of
bucks.
They're doing scenery. They're doing figure painting. They're doing
it's like a whole community
building,
it's
right?
a whole community behind it, yeah, and particularly lighting. Particularly with the armor stuff, there's quite a bit of manufacturers. 156 is a very popular scale, as well as the smaller stuff.
Yeah,
and I know that actually I should have found a link to it. It was announced at the show.
I'm gonna find it for you.
It was a Panzer III or a Panzer IV, 156 scale, and there is enough parts to build one of the like 11 or 12 variations. So you can really fill out a whole army. When we find it, we'll add it to the show notes.
I'll do that right now.
So we'll do that. So yeah, so definitely the gaming part is the asset. So I can see this as a good deal for both companies. Both companies are very successful. They're very good at what they do. So yeah, I can see that very, very well. If you hear a sudden sound, that's Mr. Sparkles leaping on the microphone. He's eyeing it up. Oh. It's all right. Yeah. He's doing fine. So is there anything else you wanted to cover that was released by your good friends at Bandai or anything else out of the announcements? There was a ton. I know there was a ton of stuff. You're probably still playing catch up. You know, anything that has the word Mega Bazooka Launcher, you just have to love.
Look out. Nothing else.
Nothing else that really catches your eye right now. We can talk about it later. So, HGUAC 1/144 Conroy's Mega Bazooka Launcher.
What's this now?
I don't know.
Oh, 16... so it's a P Bondi, the premium Bondi stuff.
Okay.
So we won't. That'll never see the light of day. And okay, that looks like
looks like one massive cannon.
It is.
With the mech on it.
They were like these. So that idea. They had these like weapons platforms.
Yeah. That's what this looks like.
From Unicorn. That looks like a Jagan or something.
Okay.
So that premium Bondi is where they do, it's like a very limited run of some kind of
So what you're
esoteric.
Getting is you're getting a kit of the weapon and the tripod.
Yeah.
And then you add your own Gundam to...
So, yeah, in the... there was a series a couple years ago called Gundam Thunderbolt. There was a couple movies and maybe an OAV.
Mm-hmm.
Or an OVA, rather. And they had these sort of weapon platforms that were giant.
Right.
And they would sort of hide them in a colony.
Okay.
Like the wreckage of a colony. And kick off like
you from pick off as things go by, yes, snipers huge or whatever. Distances. Okay, all right.
They'd be they're sort of like this no man's land.
Sneaky buggers. Yeah, okay, so well,
those
anyway, rare,
those Peabondis never. They're very. You pay a lot, and you have to go through all these like Yahoo auctions, Japan, kind of to get them. So
there must be a market, though. Yeah. I always say if they're making them, there's a market.
Well, they put out the like the variants and the more sort of esoteric designs, like maybe not the ones are going to mass produce, but I don't know how they decide on.
All right, well, good to know. Yeah. Okay, let's move on from there. We'll move on to some traditional stuff. Trumpeters got their May releases. Some of the stuff was previously announced, but we're actually seeing it. How about this for a big kit? The MiG-29 SMT Fulcrum in 1/32 scale. That's going to be a big beast.
Aggressor colors there.
Yeah, that's cool. That's the modern Soviet fighter. This is an absolute monster of a kit. Full set of decals, two full set decal sheets. The part count includes photo etch. You got a lot of weapon options. 670 parts. This thing's half a meter in length.
Wowza.
So 536 millimeters, 356 millimeters wingspan, metal landing gear, photo etch, 28 spruce.
Multimedia.
Yep.
Grooved rubber tires. That's cool.
Yeah. So again, for the MiG fans, this is a big beast, but you know, people will like it. Also for the ship guys, HMS York in 1/350th scale. So the big scale of that's a heavy cruiser from the British Royal Navy during World War II. It was actually the pilot ship for the York class. And it participated in the Norway campaign, in the Mediterranean, stuff like that. So it looks like a fairly nice kit. Again, 500 millimeters in length. Metal anchor chain parts, 17 sprues, 330 parts. Two directional slide mold hull, deck wood pattern finely rendered with a display stand, and as I said, the obligatory photo etch. 1/350th scale from the Russian modern stuff, the Katsamra-Etima anti-tank system. It's the 9P-157. It's an anti-tank. Looks like an APC, 1/35th scale. This thing carries two missiles on launch rails.
Looks very modern.
It's reloaded automatically from an internal magazine with 15 rounds. That's interesting. So that's kind of nice. You don't have to risk your life reloading.
It looks like the BMP chassis.
Yeah, it looks like a BMP chassis. Yeah, yeah, basically.
Yeah, that's cool. Very modern. That's got those modern stripes.
Yeah. They claim that three of these are able to engage 14 attacking tanks and destroy at least 60% of the attacking force. The missile itself is supersonic at Mach 1.2,
wowza,
range between 400 and 6,000 meters. So that'll spoil your day pretty quick.
Yeah,
if you're on the receiving end. 201 millimeters in length, 14 sprues, 830 parts. So you know it's individual tracks.
Yes.
That's 830 parts with some etched photo things. Moving on, still on the Russian theme. It seems to be a Russian theme this month, the Trumpeter. The Tupolev 128 UT Fiddler in 1/72nd scale. This was a big, fairly big long-range interceptor introduced by the Soviets in the 60s. This is actually known as the largest and heaviest fighter ever in service.
Wow.
Like, this thing's huge. Like, look, there's actually two cockpits there. When you look at that picture, I remember hearing about this.
I think I have some pictures in the old Squadron Signals Tomcat book of, like, some Tomcats escorting one.
Well, or something like this. Yeah. So this one is a fighter. This was 43 tons. Heaviest fighter able to... Yeah, it was designed as a bomber interceptor. Like, you're not going to go air-to-air. The idea was you go up, you find the slow-moving bomber, you fire some missiles.
Yeah.
It wasn't intending to... It was designed to take on the B-52. Like, you're not going to get into a dogfight with this thing. Initially appeared at the 1961 Air Parade. Basically... and this is a funny thing from the article here. The only publicly reported combat operation was the destruction of NATO reconnaissance balloons. Remained in service till 1990s.
Reconnaissance balloons. Now I want to build that.
Now you want to build a NATO reconnaissance balloon.
Yeah, that sounds fascinating.
We'll see if our friends at Scalemates has one. So again, this is 1/72nd scale. Remember I said that? 439 millimeters in length. For 1/72nd scale. So
just about half a meter.
Just under half a meter.
Wow.
1/72nd scale.
Holy moly.
Yeah, like I said, it was a big fighter. A big fighter air quotes there.
Yeah,
it's basically a missile platform, right?
Right.
This thing you gotta eat. This thing would probably take 6 miles to do a 180-degree turn, but when you're taking on a B-52, which takes 12 miles to do 180, you know, it wasn't a problem. 130 parts, 11 sprues, photo etch, etc., etc. Hey, look, another Soviet release from Trumpeter. The Soviet 2B7R multiple rocket launcher, the BM-13HMM in 1/32nd scale. So your standard Soviet rocket launcher from World War II and the post-war, again, for people into these subjects. 510 parts, 12 sprues and tires, full drivetrain assembly, complete with engine transmission, the differential housing and suspension units, hollow rubber tires with a good tread pattern, and photo etch parts.
That's really neat. Like, I didn't know that. I mean, I've read a lot of articles about how to paint the grooves on the tires. So that's kind of a new little engineering. It's a new thing they do.
Yeah. So I've heard of some, and again, maybe some of our people can comment on the Facebook page. But yeah, there's a whole, I've read a few articles on how to weather tires, and rubber is totally different than plastic.
Oh, yeah. Weather,
yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like, even just painting, I was referring to painting the grooves on.
Is
like
very different technique,
I haven't done that before. Like, I didn't even think of it. I was, I've, you know, tried to weather using grays to kind of simulate the black. You know, nothing's flat, like, a straight black, right? It's always shades,
like an
tones
black.
Of gray and white,
Well, see, remember,
white,
to
right?
me, I came out with NATO black.
Yeah.
Or, like, rubber tire black. They've got two different ones that are
I love those. Those are some of my favorite colors.
Oh, I know,
NATO
black. Work really
and,
well.
And tire
work really
black.
Well, exactly. Yeah. Okay, moving on. Hobby Boss, the French R-39 light infantry tank in 1/35th scale. This is a Renault tank. It was built in the Second World War. Designed in 33, produced from 36. So it was designed as a light infantry support vehicle. It only had a 37mm gun, so it was more for infantry support.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, French tanks were always well regarded.
I've heard that.
Yeah. So 10 sprues, 460 parts. Looks like it's not individual tanks, but like it looks like there's some sections for the curves, and then they give you pre-molded ones for the...
I think this is a great idea.
Yeah, I think that is. For the upper and lower. Yeah. For the flat sections, why torture yourself?
Well, I think too, it's maybe a deterrent for people who maybe build airplanes or like beginner modelers.
Oh yeah, I remember when I first built my first 1/35th armor.
Yeah,
I built a Sherman Firefly. I picked apparently, according to the armor guys in my local club, the absolute worst tank that had individual link tracks.
Yeah, you're like, never again, more tanks.
And I have to agree because I ended up buying aftermarket rubber ones just because it was driving me nuts.
Yeah,
but yeah, they did admit that. I am going to try again. I've got some other stuff in the stash, but yeah.
Well, my first kit was a Indie Link kit.
Yeah.
I mean, I get into the. I don't mind the slog. Like,
It's fine. But these ones were apparently. Even the armor guys said these were bad.
Yeah, I feel fairly disciplined. I will go the distance on kits.
Yeah,
but you know, I could see that would really turn off people. So this is a great technique that the manufacturers are doing to just kind of
make it a bit easier. Because again, you want
get
it to be
results.
Fun. And that's what it is. It's a hobby. So also, they've got the 1/35th IDF Merkiva Mark IV. This is an Israeli-designed tank. This is their main battle tank from 2002 on.
It's such a science fiction looking.
It is. It's the kind of thing you could just, you take off the tracks, put on like a hover skirt. You got a sci-fi hover tank, right? Yeah.
I want to do like a hover tank version.
Well, if I recall, this is the one. The engine's actually in the front of the vehicle.
Oh,
protects
okay.
the crew, if I recall. I think it's this one.
What can we learn about it here?
So it's actually capable of carrying 8 infantry soldiers. Yeah, this is the one. So
Whoa,
the engine's
seriously?
In the front. Yep. And it's got a little cab in the back. You can carry up to 8 soldiers or some litter. Yep, I remember that.
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
So there's a crew of 3. Crew of 4. My apologies. It can also fire against attack helicopters. This demonstrated high hit probability in firing against attack helicopters using conventional anti-tank munitions. Can you imagine that if you're like piloting a Hind or something and this thing points its barrel, you're probably going to laugh. It'll be the last thing you ever see.
Wow, deadly.
Yeah, so it must be
fast. I thought they were very... It's a very modern...
It's a very modern Israeli
design.
Yeah. 700 parts, photo etch parts included. Yeah, this is one I wouldn't mind. I wouldn't mind building. Metal chain.
Oh, it has that anti-RPG.
It will have
like
that
skirt
too.
With the weighted chains. Wasn't that what that was for? Behind the turret?
Yeah, there's some stuff like that. This one here, I don't know if it's got a chain for that, but look, it's got like a whole bunch of, looks like just a chain for like a towing
like
chain.
Like a tow? But yeah. You know, the, I'm, yeah, thinking, know I'm not about. Sure if it was the one, two, or three, but it had like a skirt made of chains with
yeah, it would chains. Yeah, it would help keep the was, thing at bay, yeah.
Yeah, I know meant to like detonate about. RPG rounds yeah, exactly. before it got into the, exactly. the turret.
Yeah, so this looks like a very nice... A very nice, nice release.
Yeah, because there's been a number of companies that have already done the Merkava.
Yeah, so this is improved armor protection, gun and electronics. This is the fourth generation of this tank.
Cool.
So, yeah, it was produced about 15 years ago. So, yeah, for those who like that. I also notice, was it MiG? You know how they have the finishing sets?
Oh, yes.
There's a one for the Israeli Defense Force now. It's been released. So you can weather up your Israeli Defense yes, Force tanks.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are interested in.
Yeah, yeah. Well, there's subject. Been a lot of new releases with the Israeli Defense Force. I know a lot of people build it. Okay, moving on. Atalari, six releases here, all different. So the first one is another one of their battle sets. I remember these when I was a kid, years ago. They produced these.
Repop?
It might be, but this is 172nd scale. So this is based on the Pegasus Bridge during D-Day. So on D-Day, this was a bridge that was over a canal on the western or on the eastern flank. Of the invasion of of the Normandy invasion.
Okay.
So they sent the British paratroopers in. They had to capture this bridge because otherwise the Germans would come in. So they held it for like 36 hours behind enemy lines, and some very famous books written by it. So this is basically.
Was there a good vintage film?
Well, it was detailing. It was in The Longest Day, which is the
Longest Day. Yes.
So they talk about it like hold until relieved. Yeah. And this is all in. So this includes, in 72nd scale, 50 German infantry figures, 50 British paratroopers, an Opel Blitz trucks, a Kuba wagon car, a Pack 40, Pack 35, Pack 38 guns with nine figures for those, battlefield accessories, and the Pegasus Bridge. Now, this is a new part. This is made out of MDF laser cut wood. So you got a nice little thing for a diorama there, and again, plenty of signs and all that. So this is quite a cool little thing. So yeah, there's and again in the attachments we show the laser cut bridge. That's definitely new. That wasn't in that wasn't in the old thing.
But was it would have been molded with like styrene plastic?
Probably, if they had like something like that. Yeah, I remember some of that was like that. Yeah. So basically, yeah, what happened was they landed in their gliders. And they held the bridge. And, it's one of the most famous battles of the war. So you also got, like, various, accessories. So these were neat because if you needed to get a bunch of accessories for your 172nd scale dioramas, it came with a lot. So, yeah, the figures look very good castings. I think I have the Atalari Pack 40 from something else. And it was a good little kit. I still have it. It assembled well. So quite a few things there. And then they show some pictures of it fully made up. And you can add some trees and diorama, stuff like that. So,
awesome.
nice little thing, certainly good for some other possibilities. So definitely check that one out. Also, they have, for the truck guys, and I know our friends at the Scale Model, we're the Scale Model podcast, our friends at On the Bench, they had a gentleman talking about trucks and rig building. That was I learned quite a bit there.
Yeah, that was neat. I want to build a truck.
Yeah, so there's one you can look at. The Scania R400 Streamline Flat Roof in 1/24 scale. So it's 24.7 centimeters in diameter. So that's pretty big.
That's 52 beautiful,
euros. Yeah, isn't that nice looking?
It's like a spaceship.
Yeah, love fuel it. Economy, driver comfort and reliability, two decals. Two sets of decals, chrome adhesive. That's different.
So
it's not. I don't think it's even. It looks like it's a sticker, not even
a sticker, but to give you a nice option, chrome finish. Yeah. I wonder how it looks.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe any listeners out there have had an experience with that.
Yeah, we'll
see. If they like it, is it effective?
Yeah, because I'm sure the more advanced modelers could just paint that. But
it's popular to use the chrome, the Molotow, those pen marker, paint markers, right? Or I'm still using Alclad for all that stuff, but
yeah, it is. Metallic adhesive,
the,
it says. goes there. Yeah,
the Molotow.
Yeah, some people don't like it. So definitely check that one out. Also, again, we're talking about video game tie-ins and that. They've released another one with their War Thunder, which is another game. Mm-hmm. So this is actually a combo pack. This is the UH-1C and the Mi-24 helicopter pack. So this is in 1/72nd scale, and you get both helicopters with, you know, basically, again, designed for the beginning modeler. Two model kits, colored sprues, and a reference guide. Even comes with some glue. And you get the bonus code for the game.
Okay.
So again, you know, so
that's
again,
another sort of beginner set to tie.
Beginner to set to tie in with the games, exactly.
Yeah, to sort of get those.
Yeah, and you got some neat little add on, you know, shark mouths and various things that you can add, make customize it yourself.
So just, but they look just sort of fictional.
Those ones are the fictional at the bottom, but the top ones, you know. But again, it gets people interested.
Yeah.
So again, you've
got nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, you've got both the Huey. Excuse me. You got a nice little display, and you got the Hind, the Mi-24.
The Hind, eh?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah,
that's
so nice it comes with both. Also, we have the Fokker F-27 Friendship. This is a two-engine commuter, short to medium-range commuter plane, similar to our Canadian -8s.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a 1/72nd scale, 36 euros. Yeah, it's been around since the 50s. Wow, I didn't realize it was that old. So it's been around for a while.
Cool. Sleek.
Yep, bunch of different versions, three different versions for airlines. Definitely worth checking out, you know, your standard like that. For the armor guys, Kangaroo. This is a kit, a 1/35th scale. The Kangaroo is like an APC based on the Lee or the Grant chassis.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you basically... yeah, they basically took the old M7 Priest, the assault gun, took the gun out, put a little bit of armor in, take the roof off, you got a way to carry troops.
Yeah, yeah, very cool. That's a cool subject.
Yeah, they're infantry transport vehicles.
One for our Australian friends.
Yep, exactly.
Now, the Canadian version was just the universal carrier, right? It was
the British. The British had one called a Bren universal carrier. It was smaller.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a big, completely different size. This is a full size one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
I'd like to do the Priest sometime. Did the Priest have a rocket launcher?
No, the Priest had the Priest had the artillery piece in front. Yeah. They called it the Priest because the gun was in the middle, but the side gun for the 50 for the machine gun.
Yeah,
the actual cupola for it resembled like a Priest thing because it was round.
Oh, like a pulpit or something.
Yes. Yeah, that's why they called it the Priest.
That's funny.
And you can see a little bit of it there, see? Right.
Yeah.
There. That's what that looked like in there. So,
yeah
so that's kind of cool. Bunch of different schemes. Again, 1/35th scale. Rubber tracks, for those of you who don't like that. It looks like...
I bet you those rubber tracks are just fine.
Oh, I bet you they are. But I'm sure there's people out there screaming at us right now. But that's fine.
I think they've come a long way. It's not like a 70s rubber track.
To each their own. But again, for some people, that's all they want to do.
Yeah.
I told you, when I built that Firefly, in the end I went with rubber tracks.
But was that a vintage kit?
No, it was a fairly recent Dragon. Like it just had 90s? Crappy individual... Yeah, it had crappy individual tanks.
I think I've looked at a few... I have a couple more modern kits, and they have rubber tracks, and they actually look really well detailed. Okay. And I hear they've designed them now, so they take paint well.
I have to admit, the aftermarket ones I got for the Firefly did take paint well. They were like rubber tracks, quote unquote, but they were very good.
They've changed the formula accept paint and to glue well.
Exactly.
And, that one kit I was showing you, this trumpeter kit from a couple of years ago has rubber tracks, and they look beautiful.
Exactly. So as we look in here, as long as he doesn't step on the cat, we're even getting a live preview here of rubber tracks. We're going to take a picture of these.
They look slick.
Let's have a look here. Yeah, they look not bad.
So the kit we're referring to, listeners, is the 1/35th Japanese ground self-defense force.
89 IFV.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, we'll put a picture of that in the show notes.
Yeah, maybe, I don't know, 10 years ago?
Yeah, at least. We'll check it on scale, mates. Here we go. Don't forget the tracks. So rounding out Italery, 1/72nd scale, free French infantry. So again, we were talking about war gaming. This is war games approved, free French infantry. For those people who play bolt action or stuff like that. So for 10 euros.
in scale then?
Some again, yeah. There's different scales, you know, so people can adapt to whatever scale they want. So that looks pretty good.
Yeah,
bunch of different figures. Some are, you know, stretcher bearer guys in various molds or whatever. So that's from Atelier. We warned you there was a lot of releases this month.
Yeah, that's a full episode.
Okay, for Canada, I know the Canadian armor guys are really happy about this.
A lot of buzz about this.
Yeah, this is the from Bronco. This is the Ram Bronco models 35th scale cruiser tank. This is the Ram Mark II early preview. It's been a while since we've seen anything. So this is an early production 135th scale. This was originally built, and the idea is it became a training tank. They were originally going to, the Canadian government in 1940 was going to build a tank, what they call a cruiser tank, a medium tank,
okay,
for Canadian Army. And they were going to use the chassis from the M3 Lee. So they used the M3 lower hull, but then they cast their own upper hull and turret. So they actually built 50. That was designated as the Ram Mark I, and it mounted a 2-pounder gun. The Mark II came with the more powerful, which they needed an the 6-pounder anti-tank gun. Unfortunately, the gun wasn't ready until 1942, and by then the Americans had developed the M4 Sherman.
Ah,
so okay. Basically, the M4 Sherman, they could just produce them, you know, in hundreds. So they no longer needed it, but they did continue to produce it as a training tank. So many crews, particularly of the Commonwealth, just like, you know, the Tiger Moth and the Harvards were used for the air pilots, mm-hmm, many tank crews learned on these ramps.
Trained on these, okay.
Yep, they had side doors. So again, I know a lot of people, I didn't know a lot about it until recently, but same I know here. A lot of people are, I know the Canadian armor guys are really excited.
Yeah, I think this it's needed some attention and has been sorely overlooked for quite a long time.
Yeah, they were actually, the Dutch army used them until 1952.
Okay, and they were deployed in Northwest Europe there,
yep.
44 to 45.
Yeah, a few, just a few. Yeah. Mostly for artillery regiments for support there. And then a lot of them were converted to the Kangaroo heavy APC or gun tractors. Definitely a nice looking kit. Couple of variations. So they made a Ram 1, 2, and 3, and it's basically the gun up market. Looks like Bronco's produced another good one here. Accurately slide-molded side parts, ports early, turret with the casting pattern.
This is going to be beautiful.
Yeah, I'm sure, and I'm sure once we see some more stuff, we'll see what the purists think. Yeah. This is all based on the CAD version. There's going to be a lot of photo etch. So not a lot of release is yet, but I'm sure we'll hear more about it.
Now, Bronco is kind of known for doing sort of complicated kits, but they look good.
Yeah,
I've heard something about like the Staghound is something interesting to me. Right. And they came out with that kit a number of years ago, and I heard it's just challenging. There's also like a Tamiya version or Italeri version that is like easier to assemble.
So it's more, these are kind of like dragon kits would be, like more detailed.
Yeah, they're probably a bit more detailed, but harder, like more count.
More parts to it and stuff like that. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I'm wondering if they scaled that back for this release or like taking in feedback from the marketplace.
Yeah, well, we'll have to see. Again, I just know there's been some buzz about it.
Yeah, looking forward to some feedback on that.
And stuff like that. So we'll see what happens there. Okay, continuing on. If we go on... What do we have next? We talked about the Badger, the tank destroyer. I think we're almost through the news, friend. I think we're almost through the news.
Keep going.
We're going to keep going. I think we're up to your Gundam stuff.
Is it?
The Max Factory. Oh yeah, this is the thing I saw, and I went, "Is this the one I saw?"
Yeah.
The giant Valkyrie about it.
Yeah, the 1-20 scale Valkyrie.
Yeah, talk about this thing. This thing's huge.
Okay, yeah, okay. So this is a 1-20 scale Valkyrie. Some people know them as Veritex.
Yep.
It's in the American series Robotech.
Robotech, yeah.
So this has been put out in 1-20 scale. The first one that came out was the Gerwak, right? Like with the legs down.
Right.
Sort of halfway between a jet and the Batroid figure. The new release for September is the 1-20 scale VF1 Super Strike fighter package, Valkyrie. Mm-hmm. So it's a fighter, and it has these fast packs. I forget what fast stands. It's an acronym for something.
Okay.
But there's a strike version, or that had the cannons, and then like mm-hmm. the fast pack was just the two like boosters. Yeah. So it's another. Huge. This is a monstrous
kit. 71 centimeters long, 71 yeah. centimeters wide, and 36 centimeters tall. Made of ABS and plastic. And with a price tag to go with it.
Just save up your pesos, because you're going to need 452...
Canadian pesos.
Canadian pesos. But it's 7 big. Cents. Yeah. Yeah, this is something else, really.
Something for the fans.
Yeah, I got a 48 scale Valkyrie, and I thought, oh my goodness, it's huge. That's
but it looks like you got a lot of different options, except yeah. some weapon sets with it.
Yeah, there's a separate armament set they're going to release.
Okay.
And there's also a separate, there's two different deckle sheets, a deluxe deckle sheet that was about right. $75 Canadian, and another deckle sheet. I wonder if you get stickers with it, but this is a very interesting thing. It's just sort of unusual, right? And
well, they obviously must have yeah. sold enough of the first one to
yeah to do the well. They've already created the the actual mold. Airframe, yeah, right?
So they're just adding, not much to do.
They're just adding the
but obviously the fast they packs. Must have sold enough to yeah. Justify it.
I think so. People are very excited about that because and these are kind of interesting kits. Like I was mentioning before that they're not like traditional kits. They're
right.
Some of the parts are like
ABS or something.
Yeah, they're pre-molded.
Pre-molded, yeah.
Yeah. But we were talking about the company that put them out is Max Factory.
Yeah.
And so this Max Factory is a company, it was like a garage kit company started okay. by Max Watanabe.
Right.
So we were talking about this guy. A couple notable things about him. I've actually included a little interview in our sites and tips section on our show notes that you can check okay. out. So he was, I think, started with Hobby Japan, which I love Hobby Japan, mm-hmm. in the early 80s, like a contributor or an editor, okay. building models. And then I'm not 100% sure when this occurred, but I remember this. Around the mid to early to mid 90s, he popularized like a pre and post shading on Gundam kits.
Okay.
And I think that really kind of took a lot of people by surprise. It looks so good.
Right.
And I think he was applying, obviously, techniques from, the regular, like, armor building right. or aircraft right. building right. and put it onto the science fiction stuff, giving it a little more air of realism.
Right.
And I loved it. I was immediately like, yes, this is amazing. I want to learn how to do that. Right. And it, got me and sucked in to that. And so he's worked with this other company, Good Smile Company, who do like figures and other different odd things, stuff, yeah. maybe some kits and whatnot, stuff, to produce these 1-20 scale Valkyries. So these are, it's a very interesting yeah. thing, right?
I did find the weapon set. So it's 85 yeah. Canadian.
Yep.
So you got a bunch of different armaments, rockets, and.
Yeah, the reactionary missiles and rocket pod. Okay. The big ones are nuclear reactionary missiles, and then they all have designations.
They all have names, you can add them to your.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like you have an option. I wonder, but these things have like the little rubber, grommets. The grommets yeah. that you can pop the weapons in and out. Would they have something like that sometimes?
I would wonder. Because
I've seen other kits that have those, right?
They do different payloads, right?
Right, like with, right. So you would wonder. Because isn't there some other Gundam kits that do that? I've seen that somewhere
else. Yeah,
all
the Gundam kits have these like grommets for... Yeah. Like for the joints, so right. you can move them because people want to. Right.
But I'm more thinking, I'm thinking of some larger weapons. Like I know the Tamiya F-16 years ago.
Oh,
they made
really?
A 1/32 yeah. scale F-16.
So you could swap them out.
And you could swap the weapons out.
Yeah.
So like it had a little rubber thing, you could a pop peg, the fuel tank yeah. up, yeah, and it would hold.
And
so I wonder if it would be something similar. Really, I think
similar
that's what
to,
I'm thinking.
I've noticed that some of the armor kits, the actual wheels have a rubber grommet
yeah,
that sits
maybe,
on the
maybe.
Like the,
yeah.
the shaft.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is.
So okay. it still moves or whatever
yeah.
if you want to pose
okay.
them.
Last but not least, before we get to scale mates, you found my 156 Panzer.
Yeah, I had a link in there.
So yeah, this that's is kind of neat. This is kind of neat for the wargaming crew. I just liked it because you got all sorts of different miniatures.
It looks pretty sharp. 28
it's
millimeter.
A good scale. And there's some other manufacturers, and I know, like I said, there's one coming out where they've done it, so there's like 20 versions you can make. They have the extra little parts that make it look slightly different.
So from the different, like, companies?
Well, no, like, let's say they produce 300, and then they went, oh, maybe we should put an extra spotlight on. So that'll be a Mark II, right? Then they produce another 200 of those.
Yep.
Oh, let's add another hatch. So that'll be a Mark III, right? And of course, if you're a big fan, you know the difference. Someone's made one of these. But it gives you the idea.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you know, it's, you know, modeling and wargaming go back a long way. There's a lot of history.
And did you play some of those, like the real history model or wargame? Get into that?
Yeah, I never did that. I was a nerd. I was a total nerd.
Well, me too. I was nerding out in different ways.
I know. Total nerd. Okay. So that, believe it or not, I don't know how long we've been on the air for, but that's our news for the week. We're going to very briefly go through what's hot at Scalemates.
Let's do
it. What's hot next schedule. Of course, the Ming model's been producing a ton of Shermans, different Shermans. There's some new tools coming out there. Tamiya's Spitfire and 109, 148th and 172nd remain to be popular. What else do we have here as we go through? A lot of different, like I said, a lot of new tools. Here we go.
There's that Star Destroyer.
Bandai 15000s, new tool with the LEDs. A lot of people are talking about that.
Okay, so it has the pre-made kit.
We talked about it a couple episodes ago.
Yeah.
They were talking about it. So yeah, you can get the light thing. The ARL-44 French Heavy Tank, that's coming out from Musing Hobby. And 135th, a M4 76 millimeter Sherman. Again, a lot of different Shermans coming out. So yeah, a lot of new stuff. The Tamiya Achilles with some changed parts. That's a 17 powder tank destroyer.
That's cool. That's a neat subject.
Yep. An Eagle transporter in 172nd scale.
Another one.
Yeah. NPC round
been
two.
Quite a few modern. Yeah, different,
but that's a smaller scale, I would think.
Yeah, was it currently done in like 48th or something?
I think there were some larger scales. I'll have to double check. So yeah, there's the RAM we talked about.
I think this is really neat. The MK15 Phalanx close-in
weapons. RPG models in 135th scale. So good for a diorama. So this is something the U.S. Navy uses.
This is a real thing, and it's incredible.
Yeah, this is a real thing. So basically, it's a high-speed rotary cannon, multi-barrel rotary cannon, tied into a radar, and it's all in one thing. Yeah. So the idea is this thing's the last line of defense to stop incoming missiles.
Yeah, it's like a wall of lead.
It basically shoots out a wall of lead and
tries to knock out any kind of incoming.
It knocks out anything that hasn't already been knocked out. Yeah, they've been around for a few years, but this looks kind of cool for Navy guys. And again, you could do that in a sci-fi.
Yeah, absolutely. What kind of scale is that?
135th.
Okay, so I think it was meant to be done as sort of a standalone little thing, but I guess maybe you could do.
Yeah, this is a new release and. From RPG models.
Are there any ship kits done in 35th scale? Maybe the TT.
Nothing that would have
109 or something.
Nothing that would have on this unless you were insane enough to scratch build it.
Yeah.
And that'd be awfully.
So it's just meant to be like a little vignette.
Okay, well, let me put it this way. Imagine you've seen like 1/350 scale battleships in World War II aircraft carriers. Multiply it by 10.
Sure.
That'd be 1/35 scale. So
yeah, you're right.
There's probably some evil mad genius who's working on one, but yeah, you could add those.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have to scratch build them, but yeah. I don't know where you put it.
New monsters, but that was like a fun little build. Right?
Yeah, that's kind of cool from our friends at Scalemates. So moving on, we're going to stop a bit and talk a bit about our good friends at Goodman Models. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's you.
That's me.
So we already talked about you're going to be vending
at Torcan.
At Torcan,
and that is May the 26th.
25th, 26th.
25th, yeah, that weekend in Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, come say hi. I'll have lots of Super Saiyan singles available if you want to try them out or if you just want to get a replacement. And I'll have lots of the sets.
Awesome.
They're going to be well-priced. It's always a show special.
Always is.
Yeah,
always
and is. When you get this set, keep it handy on your bench and you're going to use them on all your construction projects. You're going to clean up your seams. I've actually been using them a ton on the APC that I've been doing just to clean up a lot of the seams and work at putty. Work at super glue that I've been using as seam filling just to get a nice clean pass when I'm trying to shape that plastic
patch and up the stuff. Yep, and I know a set's swinging its way down to our fan Ray in Australia.
Yes, it's coming, Ray.
I'm afraid it's probably on the slow boat, Ray. Our apologies.
It's on the slow boat to China with a stop in Australia.
Yeah, Australia. But no, I just want to point out as well, just for talking about the sanding block, because he's looking forward to it, because he's working on a Constellation aircraft model.
Yeah, he had some working pictures there, project pictures.
So he's looking forward to trying these on that.
They're
so
coming, Ray. They're coming, man. There.
Hopefully, we're looking. I know you're looking forward to them. We're going to definitely make sure.
Next time I'll airmail them. I think I should have done that in the first place. That's my apologies.
That's all right. So we'll do that. So definitely. So we're still working on the website.
It's coming. Yeah,
it's coming. I'm actually teaching Anthony how to build a website. But in the meantime, you can still get them on Facebook.
Yeah, you can definitely order them up directly from me on Facebook. I've got them in stock right now, and I just sent out a big load to my buddy Justin at Section 8 Hobbies in Buffalo. So he's going to have them in stock.
Right.
They're still in stock at our friends at Flexifile. You can buy the sets. And
Wheels and Wings still have them.
Wheels and Wings has a good selection of all the singles.
You know what? They ended up photobombing
a
video. So I posted on the Facebook page about a video about an independent filmmaker did about various modelers and modeling and the hobby.
Yeah, it's kind of both the general
idea of the hobby and why people do it. It was quite good.
Yeah, it was really well done.
So again, if you check back to our podcast Facebook page, but what was neat about it is they shot a lot of coverage at Hamilton this year when we were there, and they were also at our good friends at Wheels and Wings.
Yeah.
They interviewed the owners, and there was one segment where they're kind of just overlooking the store, and I looked and I went, hey, there's Anthony's singles right there.
They have a really nice display. They did a great job.
They were good.
That.
They were a really good job. So you can get them there as well.
Yeah, you get them there as well, and Wheels and Wings do mail order. You just have to, I think, email them and they'll send it to you.
Yep, they email it. That's like I said, I picked up my weathering pencils.
Yeah, that's where they came from. So. And I think they're also still in stock at culttvman.com for my friends in the States, and out east at Elm City Hobbies has them as well
now. What we need to do? Maybe we need to, again, we've been saying, we need to get a distributor out in Australia for our friends there.
Yes.
I wonder if there's a very good Australian store called B&A Hobbies. Yeah. That's the one that everyone seems to use down there.
I've actually bought stuff from them.
I wonder if we need to get in touch with them. So if any of our listeners have an inside line.
Actually, somebody did
to the owner of B&A.
Yeah, somebody did reach out about getting distribution in Australia, and I wanted to thank them for that tip.
Yeah, because I know some people there would like it, and we'd love to get them down there.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm saying the royal we. Anthony would love to get them down there. So, you know.
I would.
And if Anthony's happy, I'm happy. So there you go. So yeah, definitely check them out, and as always, we thank them for their support.
You're welcome. It's my pleasure.
Okay, so on to our topic. So, yes, our friends in the land down under, Australia, the other amazing hobby podcast, modeling podcast,
my favorite one.
The bench. Yeah, we seem to have a little, there seems to be a little bit of a tete-a-tete going on. This was originally about some comments about, you know, maple syrup and the Canadian thing. Mm-hmm. So it was countered with when I sent back a picture of the fact that the Australian F-18s had been shipped off with the kangaroo repellent system. So they have to be shipped back. And then Ian was saying, I won't say it's disparaging, but just the whole thing about Gundam. Oh, it's a Gundam or something to that effect.
Well, they were doing a review of that Crusher Joe fighter.
Yeah.
And said, oh, it's just a Gundam.
So we kind of pounced on that as we do. So we invited Ian that he should try one. And it's like we've said before, it's always worth trying something new.
It is, you know, it's tough. I find the modelers who build real world subjects, if they're not already interested in everything, I think they look at it a little cross-eyed.
Yeah. And that's fine. And so anyway,
sure.
Kudos to Ian. He's agreed.
Good for you.
He's agreed. And of course, as expected. And guys, we realized you were going to throw something back.
Yeah.
They make it sound like we'd be surprised about this because they still think we have snow on the ground here. the snow's melting, guys. So anyway, they sent a challenge back. They want us to build a late '60s car, muscle car, preferably a Mopar.
This is one of Ian's favorite subjects.
Yeah. So he
ships
wants
and muscle, he likes, American
he likes
muscle.
His American muscle cars. So Anthony's agreed.
Yeah, I'm
so
in.
We're gonna find a nice kit. There's a couple. I was looking around on the weekend. There's a couple of good possibilities. Yeah. So if we can find a good Mopar he likes, if not, there might be a Ford GT.
Well, I was thinking
what do you think of?
I was thinking of the Shelby Cobra.
Yeah, that's right.
Now I'm thinking of the Shelby Cobra from Gunsmith Cats animation, where they faithfully reproduce the one of the Shelby Cobras, and I remember it being really cool.
Yeah.
And then I was looking around. I tried to just sort of roughly see what the kits were at. I couldn't really find what I was looking for. So then I was also thinking of the 1968 Ford Mustang GT from Bullitt.
Yep. And classic movie.
Awesome, right?
Yeah, that classic again, movie, that went up against a Dodge Charger, and the Dodge Charger lost big time.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep,
I think Bullitt was driving the...
Steve McQueen drove the car.
Yeah, yeah. Like the character Bullitt, right? Was he a detective?
He was, the good guy was driving the Mustang.
The Mustang.
And yeah, one of the most famous chase scenes ever in a movie. And it's on YouTube incredible. And stuff.
Still incredible. Absolutely amazing. And just a great film, right? A great sort of cop film.
It was. So
yeah, so maybe that.
I'm going to do that.
I'm going to hunt down this kit. We're heading to the show. Usually, there's good deals.
Yeah, find it to Torcan. If I can find something reasonable, I may build something. I like that era.
They
made some nice stuff. Yeah, yeah. I like some of the racing stuff from back then, like the old Ford GT40.
Yeah,
stuff like that. So we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, we'll definitely zero in on something. We'll try and keep it. I guess so. We were discussing Mopar, and I didn't really know what that reference was.
Yeah, so that's the parts division of Chrysler.
Yeah, so Motor Parts, right?
Motor Parts was the short form.
And then Ford was
Autocraft, something like that. Yeah, something like that. And AC Delco was GM.
Right. Yeah.
So each of the manufacturers had their own
Of official parts for. Yeah. For their
vehicles or for souping them up or all that. So
to see if we can honor Ian's Mopar.
Yeah, so now the other thing our friends came up with, they came up with a great name.
Yeah, they did.
What was it called again?
The Moosaroo Cup.
Moosaroo Cup. Yeah, so
this is great.
I'm going to see if I can find something that will let me design a quick logo, and we'll see if we can have something. Because if we have something fun, if we can get someone to design a good logo, we need something with like a moose and a kangaroo.
Yeah.
Not like doing anything coat of rude. Arms. Yeah. Not doing anything rude to each other, please.
Yes, we are the gentleman modelers.
Yes, maybe it's something we can look at selling on. The lads down there already have t-shirts with their logo available.
So advanced.
We're going to do something like that similarly too, but maybe it's something we can both combine on. So as always, gentlemen, we're glad to participate. And,
yeah, it's going to be fun.
We'll have to do some build updates.
I'm very excited.
Stuff like that. Yeah, Anthony's so excited, Ian, that he's adding to the show notes a bunch of. Ideas and tips.
I promised I would get some reference material.
Yeah.
Because there is reference material. It is a real...
And he's... It is giving you an absolute ton of reference
material. Real science fiction subject. Well, it does exist in a context. Yeah. So,
Then I guess the other thing too, Ian, if there's something you think that would be a good kit for us to try or for Anthony to try, feel free.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let us know. Again, that's one of the secrets. Try something new. Now, here's something that I ended up getting on the weekend. I decided to get one of those toon tanks.
Those little cartoon type toon tanks. Now, which one?
I got the King Tiger.
Oh, the King Tiger.
Just to try it. And because I've heard very good things. I remember at the Hamilton show, a young lady in the juniors category painted up the Sherman in pink and purple, and it won a prize. It was very good.
Yes, I actually was judging on the juniors category.
And again, it's just something different. Something quick and easy, and you can have fun with stuff.
You need a project that's a shot in the arm, right? Yeah, you can get through it quick.
And that's the thing I find sometimes, is that when I'm building, for example, with Battlestar Pegasus, I've been in a little bit of a rut. I've got like 16 decals to put on, but it's taken the better part of 3 weeks. I just haven't.
I haven't really wanted
to crack open another kit. So I finally finished those last night. So I'm able to keep going.
Yeah.
And the rest of it will go together really quick.
Push through
really
sometimes,
quick.
Instead of getting
sometimes,
distracted.
So it's sometimes good to do that. Now, I try and really keep to my rule to have no more than two in progress, and that's the problem right now. Both of my two in progress are ones I'm stalled on. The other one's the Hasegawa Lancaster, but I don't mind trying new things. I've still got another Gundam to build at some point, lots of interesting stuff. So we really look forward. So I always, and I know the guys in Australia have said the same thing, try something new sometimes.
Yeah.
Take something out of your comfort zone.
Well, it's neat to apply all the things you've learned to
different techniques will apply to
genre,
other
right?
things
and obviously
exactly.
Ian's a competent well experienced modeler, so I'm very
I don't
excited.
Know if you ask Dave sometimes he says different things about it, so I don't know.
Yeah,
but
this is a very brave choice. I love that he picked the Urjaja. It was designed in the 80s, right? So went crazy on the designs. They're very exotic looking, so I included some info there,
background
info for you there, Ian, and a link if you want to read up more more. There's a whole history. There's like development. There's all the specifications for that suit and kind of what it was all about. So
obviously they didn't worry about camouflage because this thing's like a bright orange.
Yeah, this is like a space-based mobile suit. So it's dark.
You're up on sensors anyway.
Yeah, you're gonna be dark in space.
Okay.
I think that they could really just go for squadron colors as bright as they want.
Right.
It wasn't an issue.
And again, if he wants to paint a different color, paint a different color.
Yeah.
It's whatever works for you, right?
Whatever you like, it's your
whatever
project.
Whatever you like. It's your model, you build it. Okay. On the bench, as I mentioned, I've got Pegasus going on. I finally got those flight pod decals are done.
Wonderful.
Yeah, they went okay. Again, good trimming. The Mobius decals are wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
Nice.
Thin. I just had to get my tailing gear, and they love warm water. That's the only thing. They really love warm water.
That seems to always really help.
You put warm water in, they're off in 30 seconds. You put them in cold, they're like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
So I really noticed that with them. I used a little bit of Tamiya decal set. It went on beautifully.
Nice.
So, yeah, I'm hoping the next 2 weeks it'll be done, because now that that's done, it's just really putting the flight pods together. Everything's painted. It's just putting the flight pods together, attaching them to the hull, and then doing the weathering and all that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the main hull's done. That's been painted.
The fun part.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and those ones, you know, use the inks and stuff like that.
Did you do any lighting on this project?
I didn't. No, I haven't done any lighting. There is lighting kits, and I've seen people to do it. One day, it's on my list one day to do that.
Yeah.
Hasn't really crossed my... You know, it's something I want to try one day.
You got to be like, you don't have to.
Especially with the fiber optics and that. So much new technology. I remember years ago, I built I think it was a 1/350th Enterprise kit from Star Trek Motion Picture.
Cool.
And it had the old style lights that were like hot and stuff like, and it was a pain in the...
Oh, like grain of wheat bulbs.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And the whole thing hooked up, and it had the battery, 2 C-cell batteries that were in the secondary hull. So it was an absolute pain. Of course, it broke fairly quickly. But it's come a long way. And I see that, our friends at Starship Modeler and all that, they have some amazing stuff with the fiber optics now and the LEDs.
Yeah, it has become quite, I think, a lot more user-friendly. And the parts
are readily available. It's a perfect segue, because you're putting some stuff on your APC.
Yes.
So what have you been working on?
Well, I've been cranking away on the M577 APC from Aliens, and that was like, you know, it's basically a box, right?
Right.
With a couple wheels.
Right.
So I had to light it. I think we've talked about this a little bit. So I got all the lighting finished. It works. I'm thrilled. I think it looks great. I'm pretty happy. I'll light it up for you and show you after. So now I'm working on... I wanted to include a driver figure, and I had these great dragon. It was a Dragon Shanghai Dragon Nam series.
Okay.
I think they're out of print now.
All right.
I've had them since maybe the early 90s when they came out, but it was like a set of like different posed Huey crew figures.
Okay.
So in keeping with the spirit of the design of the alien stuff, it was very Vietnam inspired.
Perfect.
So I've got that working on that guy. He's got to go in, and then I'm going to button up the whole thing, and then I can actually paint it, weather it, and put some stowage on it, and it'll be done.
And you're going to play a little bit with the weathering pencils I brought you.
This is a wonderful set. The set that I'm going to try out, and I will post some pictures and some more progress shots, is a green and brown shading and effect set.
And if you need to borrow some rest in that, let me know, because I've got most of the other ones.
We'll try them out.
New technique. I'm going to take some of them to our next club meeting so the guys can see them as well.
These are really great. I'm going to get
some. I know I've been talking about these a lot, guys and girls, but I really like them. I like seeing a new product category.
Now, before we started recording, we gave this a quick little... a little test out.
Yeah.
On the
you had a chance to try it for the first time.
Half the thing is painted already because I had to put some stuff in.
Right.
And we tried it out. I think they're like awesome. They were really easy to use.
And you'll take some pictures and post them to the Facebook page.
I'll try and take more details so you can see.
Too. Okay, good stuff. And then you also had your Academy 135th.
Yeah, talk MIFE. About stalled out projects. But I am getting closer.
It's looking good, though. It's looking good.
It's almost great. Done.
Yep.
And I don't know if I told you the story about... okay, so this is a...
It's just our little secret. No one else is listening.
All right.
No worries.
Lazy There was an episode, When Things Go Wrong.
Yeah. Okay. In this week's episode of When Things Go Wrong and Lazy Modelers.
So what was I doing? I have this brush cleaner that I love.
Yes.
And it's called Brush Magic.
Brush Magic,
Brush Magic, made by Deluxe Materials.
Yes, I love Deluxe Materials.
Who make a lot of great stuff. Yeah. It's like a brush restorer, brush cleaner.
Okay.
And so I decided that it was time. I have two bottles, kind of like, you know, the first pass and the second cleaner pass.
Right.
And I'm cleaning brushes and I'm getting it about 2 inches away from my, like, beautifully 2 years.
Oh, I can see what's about to happen.
And I decide, I should like strain out the first one and like put it in a new container and like, you know, clean it up a bit. And I just decide, just in that square 5 inches right in front of my workspace with all my stuff, I should definitely just do that. And
Yeah, exactly.
And I do it, and it splashes.
It splashes.
What did you drop something and a goofy kind of butterfingers? Yeah. Like,
okay.
And it splashes all over the MIFE that I'm working on. And, you know, you don't go figure, it like melts the paint and the decals, and there's like.
That's the swearing I heard. For those who don't know, Anthony and I live in the same city. In fact, we actually live less than half a kilometer from each other. So that explains the swearing I heard.
Yeah. So now there's like straps and things dangling down off the side, strategically placed.
That's not, hey, that works. It's like, you know what? It's like what some modelers used to do if they really bunged up something and be like, oh, it's battle damage.
Yeah.
Or I remember years ago, some aircraft guys would put, oh, the canopy's covered, protected from the sun. It's because something happened to the canopy.
Yeah.
So that's, hey, that's great creativity.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was very close to bidding this thing. I was like, nope, I think that's the end of that.
So you're going to take some pictures.
Yeah, I'll take a picture.
Take some pictures.
So I was able to just move some stowage around and put a strap where a couple, like, these little splashes. Oh, my goodness.
Awesome.
So I was having one of those internal freakouts, right? Because it's like melting the deck. It landed on a decal and melted it. I was like, oh, my goodness.
You know what? We should probably do a segment sometime on modeling disasters.
Oh, for sure.
So if any of our listeners have stories, we feel free to post them on the Facebook page. I'll try and remember to put up a topic page, and you guys can talk all about that.
Yeah.
Your disaster.
But you know, it's one of those things. Don't be lazy. Move your stuff when you're cleaning your airbrush.
Kind of important. But you know what? Yeah. We've all done it.
We've all done it.
Or, you know, you've got, how about the Microsol and Microset bottles?
Yeah.
Those are so easy to tip.
Yeah.
I built a little wood thing.
Remember that?
And other people have made similar things. You can get
It's a great idea.
Printed ones. Same thing with the Tamiya glue. Like, I haven't had the problem, but the extra thin glue, the square bottles, it's actually, once they get about half full, it's easy to knock that thing.
Well, the lesson for me was move your, you know, your beloved project away from the
area.
And
it turned out well. It still looks good. No, the weathering's nice.
I brought it back from the
I think you have. And it looks awesome. So
a little strap there kind of hanging down. And,
oh, okay. Yeah. So that's where it went.
There's
okay.
a little something
you wouldn't even
there.
Know. You wouldn't even know.
That's right. Nobody knows. It's a secret.
I wouldn't even know. No, because just the two of us. No, it's like, not like
just
we're recording.
Between me and me.
Yeah, just between us. So we'll take a picture of that, too.
Okay. Yeah, we'll show that. Yep.
Let's get this wrapped up before we drive everyone to sleep.
There.
Sites and tips. So, IPMS Venezuela. They posted recently to a couple of Facebook sites. They have an amazing magazine. I think they've done 6 issues called World Model Magazine. Well worth checking out. Very professional. If you get a chance, download one of these issues.
So they are available like PDF form?
PDF form, they're through Mega. So you download it through like a third party. But I was very, very impressed with the quality of the magazine. It's in English and Spanish, and just absolutely... absolutely an amazing mag.
Cool.
Well worth a look.
It's always great to get some inspiration too. Right?
Yep. So definitely kudos to these guys. I did mention to them that I'm going to feature it on the show.
Excellent.
But full color. Like, it looks like, you know, some of the professional grade stuff you'd see.
Very cool.
So definitely give that a check. Give them a follow. They're on Facebook. So definitely do that. Like I said, I was very impressed with it.
I'll look them up.
Okay, that's my link. You had one too.
Yeah, I I included something quite interesting here. It's a series on YouTube put out by IPMS Toronto and Barbican. And it features Dave Brown of Hornet Hobbies. And that was a really...
We know Dave.
Dave Brown's a great guy. And we had him down at the IPMS London Club to do a demo. Mm-hmm. It was wonderful. Mm-hmm. And he was the owner and shopkeeper of Hornet Hobbies, which was a really established Toronto store that actually, I think he just retired and closed it, and kind of sad for a lot of people.
He's still doing some other projects, he said.
Yeah, I'm not sure what he's been up to, but I'll have to catch up with him. But you know what? He was actually a really early supporter of the Super Saiyan blocks, and he carried them in his store, and I was very appreciative of that. And he is a fantastic modeler.
Yep.
And so he put out a series, I think, with must have been some of the members of IPMS. And it's amazing. I'm just going through it now in detail, and I am loving it. It's blowing my mind. So awesome. He started out doing, he did a series of videos with Mike Rinaldi, who is a fairly well-known modeler who put out a series of books with weathering armor, and they're very successful. People love them. And then he did another series. This is the one I've been watching. It was called, I think it was called The Groundwork.
Right.
And because I've got like this, the APC, the Aliens APC, and the M113 variant that I'm doing, I want to put them on. I love putting stuff on bases with figures and giving it context, right? So I was trying to get some ideas. I haven't done too much, so I was just trying to get knowledgeable on it. And so he's done this series. He does the first one with a Sherman that another fellow built, and he does the base work, and he walks you through all the steps and talks about some of the principles and some of the like design aesthetic. And it's awesome. So thank you, Dave. You're rocking my world. Awesome. And then he did another series I'm going through where he does a King Tiger that's been like shot.
Yep.
It's like burnt out. Yep. It has like a shell damage, you know, like the burn entry point, all that. And he puts that on a little base. And Barbican is this little company that makes like hydrocowl plaster, like streets, like you look like World II era, like cobblestone streets or like little accessories for dioramas and vignettes and that kind of thing. So I've been going through that. It's a huge series. It's really great. Dave is just a super skilled modeler, and he kind of breaks it down.
He makes it very easy.
Some great ideas.
Very well, exactly.
And he was a wonderful presenter when I had him down to the to your club.
That's right.
And so I'm going through that. It's a great little series to get into.
I know of his series, and when I was first getting back into armor, that's one of the ones I followed. So I'm really pleased to found that. So
I'm loving it. I sort of watched bits and pieces, but now I'm going through an order and kind of being, and I'm trying to adopt some of those ideas as I go forward. So I included that. It's a great little watch.
All right. So I think that's about it. We just have to give a shout out to our latest Patreon supporters.
Yes, thank you very much.
I was very bad and failed to do that at the beginning.
Oopsie.
Michael D. And again, if I'm slaughtering your names, my apologies in advance.
Michael DeFelice
and Ethan Idenmill are our latest two Patreon supporters.
Yeah, thank you guys.
So thank you very much.
Really appreciate that.
One of the things the Patreon supporters do get, they get advanced viewing of certain videos. Mm-hmm. So we did a interview with Christoph Pulinsk from AK Interactive at the IPMS Hamilton.
Yep.
So our Patreon supporters got an advanced 2 weeks heads up on that before anyone else did. Video just went public on Monday, yesterday on Sunday.
And where can
you can get that
find
on
that?
Our YouTube channel, and I've also posted a link on the club site. So
excellent.
YouTube/ScaleModelPodcast. So you can check it out there as well. So
thank you guys. Yeah, we're gonna keep posting and recording really interesting information and tips
and
for
again,
everybody.
Yeah, and you know, advanced stuff like when we go to the model shows and that, they will be available to our Patreon subscribers first, and we thank them for their support. We thank everyone, but we really thank those guys.
Definitely.
So, as always, don't forget to subscribe. Let us know if you have any comments or suggestions at scalemodelpodcast@gmail.com. We record roughly bi-weekly, iTunes, Google Play, and Stitcher. We have a Facebook page starting to get active there. Lots of discussion going on. And again, you'll probably see build commentary and stuff from both Ian and Anthony as they start their builds there at facebook.com/scalemodelpodcast. And as I say, we do have the Patreon page at patreon.com/scalemodelpodcast. So, and as always, if you need something else, else to get your hobby podcast fix, don't forget to check out our friends at On the Bench. And what's neat about that is that they publish every 2 weeks and they publish on the off weeks.
Fortnightly.
So you basically get your modeling fix every week.
Yeah, that's great.
Between the two things. And
yeah, their shows are very informative. I'm really enjoying them. Yeah. I'm going backwards through them.
Yeah, Anthony's playing catch up. I've been keeping up with them from the start. So that's cool. And again, you'll be seeing more news as we do our builds and stuff like that. So for the Scale Model Podcast, episode 20, my name is Stuart Clark.
This is Anthony Goodman.
Thank you and be well.